Hello everyone, and welcome to my virtual talk on the theory of kings. This work has been done mostly by my student Francesco Bollati here at the University of Milano, also in collaboration with Christoph and then Price at Monash University. And here you can already see a small preview of what I'm gonna show you in the next few slides. To start, we know that Alma is providing us with unprecedented possibilities to infer the presence of newly born planets that are still embedded in their natal disks. And of course, being this a conference to celebrate the anniversary of the HL Tauri image, I have to show the image of HL Tauri as found by Alma here on the left. And I want to compare it with our own modeling, actually done by another student of mine, Giovanni Di Piero, back in 2015, where we model the system of gaps and rings in terms of the presence of three Saturn mass planets that are embedded in the disk. While this interpretation is natural and appealing, we have to face the fact that just from the morphology of the dust continuum emission, the interpretation of this in terms of planets is not unique, and several other physical processes can create gaps in the disk. Recently, we have found a number of additional signatures that can confirm that indeed these gaps and rings are produced by planet disk interaction through the observation of gas emission and the peculiar kinematical signature that the planet provides in these observations. For example, one can observe for deviations in the rotation curve of CO, for example, due to gap opening, as done by Richard Teague and collaborators. Or one can observe the moment one map of the disk. For example, this has been done by Simon Casassus and Seba Perez in HD100546, where the moment one map shows what they call a Doppler flip around the position of the planet. Finally, the technique that I want to focus on in this talk is the one developed by Christoph and collaborators, where we observe the channel maps of CO. We observe a peculiar kink in the channel map as compared with the standard Keplerian case. And this kink is supposedly produced by the presence of an embedded planet. The way these data are usually interpreted by Christoph and collaborators is by comparing the data with a number of complex hydrodynamical simulation of the system. Here is an example where four different models are produced with differing planet mass, and one picks the one that best reproduces the data. However, this procedure is inherently very time consuming because each single simulation takes a very long time to run, and therefore it's not easy to perform a detailed fit to the observations. On top of that, it is unclear yet how does this signature scale with the planet properties, for example, the planet mass? And therefore, it's not easy to plan observations for systems for which we suspect the presence of a planet, for example, based on the dust morphology. At a more fundamental level, we still are not sure about what is the kink due to. Is it due to the wake? Is it due to the gap? Or is it maybe due to the circumplanetary material? Now, the reason why we still are struggling with this is because we yet do not have a theoretical model for the development of such kinks. And this is the aim of the current work, to provide such a model. Actually, a theory for the velocity perturbations in the disk induced by a planet already exists since several years. There are some seminal works by Ogilvy and Lubo, for example, and especially Goodman and Rafikov in the early 2000s that have explored this both at a linear and the nonlinear regime. Now, the procedure, however, one should remember that back then, in the early 2000s, most of the interest was in describing the density perturbation rather than the velocity perturbation. And indeed, Rafikov and Goodman do not present the velocity perturbations associated with their models, so it's not easy to obtain the corresponding channel maps and velocity contours. That is what we are going to do now. We go back and take the Goodman and Rafikov model, and compute the velocity perturbations. Now, the procedure is quite complicated. If you're not Roman Rafikov, it's not easy to get it. So I'll just give you a few schematic view of how this is done without going into technical details. First of all, it's easy to obtain the shape of the wake by requiring that the various waves launched at the different limbed resonances by the planet interfere constructively. And you can see here an expression for the wake. In particular, the second line refers to a constant opening angle in the disk. Now we divide the problem in two steps. First, the linear part, and then the nonlinear part. For the linear perturbation, we start from the fluid equations for a non-self-gravitating disk. We linearize these equations close to the planet, obviously including the planet potential, and we adopt the Schilling sheet approximation in two dimensions. So we solve the system in a box of size roughly equal to the thickness of the disk at the planet position. We assume that the perturbations are stationary in the co-rotating frame of the planet. And in order to solve the system of partial differential equations that come out, we move to Fourier space, we adopt specific change of variables, and we reduce the system to a simple ordinary differential equation for the Fourier transforms of the azimuthal velocity, V hat, of the radial velocity perturbation, U hat, and of the surface density perturbation, sigma hat. So these are the equations that we solve. Let's not go into the details. Once we solve them, we can go back and transform them back into the coordinate space, and we obtain density and velocity perturbations in the Schilling sheet. So we have done that. This is what we obtain. On the left, you see the azimuthal and radial velocity perturbations for the parameters written here on the top. On the right, you see the surface density. On the bottom right, you see a cut in the surface density profile for the perturbation across three different line across the wake at three different positions as marked. This is mostly to have to make sure that we compare with Rafikov's solution. Once we have the linear solution, we move to the nonlinear stage. So what we do here is that we use the linear perturbation as boundary conditions for the nonlinear problem. We drop the Schilling sheet approximation. We drop the planet potential because we are far from the planet. We use the WKB approximation. And one can show by suitably manipulating the equations that the perturbations obey an implicit Burgers equation of the kind that is shown here at the bottom. The variable chi that we solve for is proportional to the density perturbation and to the velocity perturbation. The two variables that it depends on are called t and eta. One should be careful. T is not a time variable, but it's a spatial coordinate along the wake, while eta is a spatial coordinate across the wake. We can solve for this equation. Actually, Burgers' equation naturally develops shocks and steepens into what is called the NN wave, because it's got, as you can see here, the shape of an N. So here we show the initial profile from the linear calculation and how it evolves as we move farther along the wake, and it develops this kind of N shape. It's important to remember that the area below the curve is proportional to the planet mass and is conserved along the evolution along the wake. That means that the height of the velocity perturbation in the nonlinear regime is proportional to the square root of the planet mass. And this will become important for the following calculation. So to summarize, we have calculated the velocity perturbation in a semi-analytic way following Rafikov and Goodman. An important thing to remember is that close to the planet, such velocity perturbations are linear with planet mass, while far from the planet, shocks arises and the perturbation turns out to be proportional to the square root of the planet mass. Once we have the velocity perturbation, we can compute the isovelocity curves, or the channel maps, if you like. This is one example for the parameters written there on top. And what I show here is both the isovelocity curves and below it, I also show the wake in terms of the velocity perturbation. So one can see that whenever the channel map crosses the wake, we have a kink, okay? However, as you can see here, the kinks are not localized nor in the position they're not localized close to the planet in terms of position, not even in terms of velocity, but are spread around the whole disk. This is because the wake doesn't vanish even if you move far away from the planet. So if you want to have a localized kink, basically we have to dump the velocity perturbation away from the planet. And we do that by following again another old paper by Xu. So we apply this damping factor that is shown here, that obviously depends on the dissipative terms that we are trying to mimic here, and in particular on viscosity. So here I show the expression where we use an alpha prescription for the viscosity. Once we apply this damping, this is what we get. And you can see that in this case, when we have damping, indeed the kink gets localized close to the planet position. In order to do that, we need to have an alpha viscosity, which is of the order of h over r, or a fraction of h over r. And so, say, for example, it could be a factor of 10 to the minus 2 or something like that. This, I should mention that these numbers are just order of magnitude estimates and, you know, can easily vary by a factor of a few. An application of this theory to the case of HD 163296 can be done. This is the famous case by Christophe. What I show here is on the left the actual observation, and on the right our model, where we put the planet according to the planet properties are the ones that have been derived by Christophe and collaborators. And we indeed see that there is a very nice comparison between our analytical model and the observations. And, you know, for, you know, I can also show all the other travel maps that we obtain in this case. Finally, we can compute how does the amplitude of the kink scale with planet mass. Here we define a kink amplitude as the geometrical distance between a given channel map and the corresponding one in the Keplerian approximation. We call this quantity A. And here I plot A as a function of planet mass for different channels, moving from bottom to top in these various lines. We move closer and closer to the planet. The red line here shows as a reference the scaling where A is proportional to the square root of the planet mass. And indeed we see that far from the planet, the scaling goes as expected with the square root of the planet mass, but the scaling steepens as we move closer to the planet, again, in accordance to our theoretical prediction that, you know, required that if we move closer to the planet, the scaling should be more linear than with the square root of the planet mass. So to conclude, we have developed a semi-analytical theory of the kinks produced by a planet in the gaseous disk. To do that, we have based our model on the seminal investigations by Goodman and Rafikov. And the three things to remember is that, to take away from this work, is A, that the kinks are produced indeed by the wake induced by the planet. Whenever a channel crosses the wake, we have a kink. The kink amplitude scales with the square root of the planet mass, but the relationship steepens if the channels are moved closer to the planet. And in order to have localized kinks, it is necessary to include some viscous damping in the wake. Obviously, the next steps to go forward is to produce actual CO channel maps rather than the isovelocity curves that I showed above before, by coupling our model, for example, to MCFOST and getting really the CO channel maps. And based on that, we can build up a coherent fitting procedures of observed kinks that are based on this. I call it here simple and easy to reproduce model. Actually, as you have seen, the model is not really straightforward, but is semi-analytical and can be done in a very short time. So we are confident that in a small time, we will have an actual fitting procedure for the kinks to extract the planet properties based on these observations. So thanks a lot for listening. And if you have any question, just ask. Thanks a lot.